I'm actually from Gaza. So Gaza has a long history about dealing with common goods, about dealing with game theory and dealing with institutions. And these are things which I would like to address. So to fix ideas, let's consider a simple public good game. Suppose there is a group of, say, M players who independently have to decide whether to contribute something to a common pool, knowing that this common pool will then be multiplied by the experimenter by a certain factor R larger than one, and then divided among all other players in the group. So this is an example of mutual help. If everyone helps, this is of course very good for the group, but it is easy to see that whenever there are players who are free riding on the others, then they will do better. And if we assume that those players who have a higher payoff will be more likely to be imitated, if we assume that there is some social learning going on, then there will be more and more free riders, and eventually nobody will contribute to the public good. This is very well known. We shall also assume that occasionally, of course, players are not just imitating someone else, but exploring, trying this or that. In no case are we going to assume rationality. We are using the evolutionary game theory approach. And now there are famous examples, experiments on these public good games. The one I like best is by Hermann Töni and Gechter, who did these experiments for several rounds, 10 rounds, in many different regions. And I don't want to go into the fascinating details of and differences here, but you see the overall trend. Social learning leads to less and less contributions. Players see that others in their group who are free riding are doing better, and they imitate them. Now, what to do about this depressing outcome? This is well known. There must be incentives, positive incentives, possibly rewards for cooperating, or negative incentives, punishment. And there are famous examples of this, and the most famous one dates back to the year 2000 by Fair and Gechter, who first had this, who first had these rounds without punishment, where, as before, the average contribution declined, and then at a certain moment said, okay, and so from now on, players can punish each other. They can impose penalties. They do not collect themselves these penalties, but they pay something to the experimenter so that the experimenter deduces from the account of the punished player some amount. So this is peer punishment, which is kind of self-justice. And as you see from this example, this seems to work very well, and eventually after a few rounds, it functions without anyone having to be punished. In theory, however, there are some problems about this, and in particular the problem that players can now free ride not on the contributions of others, but on the punishment of others. Because punishment, if you execute punishment, you have to pay something. It is costly for an individual to impose a punishment on someone else. And so it is better, from the selfish point of view, to let others do the punishing. Yes, the average level of cooperation will increase, but you do not have to do the punishment yourself. So this introduces into peer punishment a certain instability. And if you do computer simulations, you see that there are long periods where the peer punishers dominate the society, but these periods are always broken, interrupted by some chaotic phase. You could think, of course, that, okay, let's do some second order punishment. Let's assume that those who refrain from punishing will also be punished. This is the second line here, this graph. it shows that, well, it is a bit more stable, but essentially it doesn't work well. So there is an instability in this peer punishment situation. And in fact, we don't in our civilizations see a lot of this peer punishment. So punishment is usually assumed to be made by institutions. And this is of course the great topic of Elinor Ostrom. She said that institutions are tools that offer incentives to enable humans to overcome social dilemmas. And there is indeed, in every better developed society, there is a lot of institutional punishment, which is provided by contracts, for instance, in small-scale societies, provided by kind of strong men or sheriffs or so. There are histories of guilds or settlers who had their own sheriff and so on. So there is a bottom-up approach to institutions which can deliver punishment. And this can also be modeled in very simple way in games. And the first to do this, actually a long time before these experiments of Fehr and Gechter, was the Japanese psychologist Toshio Yamagishi, who assumed that before engaging in a round of this public good game, players could contribute something to a punishment fund. Yes, they could commit to this punishment fund. This is a kind of police force or institutions that would then collect from all defectors, from all free riders, a certain fine. And this can also be modeled by computer experiments. And the first, the difference is that there are pool punishers in this, instead of peer punishers. And the first idea is that this does not seem to work very well. But this is because we have assumed that those who do not contribute to the police force will get off scot-free. This type of free riding is not punished. But if we assume that this free riding is punished, if there is this second order punishment of those players who do not contribute to the police force, then indeed we see that there is a very stable outcome which is cooperative. It is not a very efficient situation, however, because you have to pay for the police all the time, even when there is no free rider around, when there is no occasion for the police to act. Yes? So it is costly stuff. Just one more example, maybe for showing the difference between, this is an example which shows what happens when peer punishment and pool punishment competes, yes? Pool punishers and peer punishers. And here you see in the first line, if there is no second order punishment, then the peer punishers will win out. This will be a situation which is sometimes unstable, but essentially peer punishing wins. If, however, you introduce second order punishment, punishment of those who do not contribute to the police, then after a certain initial period, there will be a very stable regime of pool punishment. Yes, it is not so efficient because you have to pay for the police, but it is a lot more stable. Now, let us try, so far these were computer experiments based on a simulation of social learning. Let's try to see what players do in real economic experiments. This is an experiment that I have done together with some collaborators, in particular Peter Bednarik, who is now also working at YASA and which was published in Experimental Economics. This is based on a large group of 238 students. They were randomly assigned to 18 different groups of 12 to 14 people each. And these groups were our toy communities, so to speak. Between the groups, there was no interaction. Within the group, players knew not each other personally, but they always knew how much, how many did what and who earned what. So in these groups, these isolated groups, played 50 rounds of this public good game, and with different ways punishing the free riders. So we have the optional public good game. Suppose that each player always receives at the beginning €3, and then he can decide to invest, for instance, €1, which is multiplied by 3 and divided amongst all other participants. We assume also that the players can abstain from the game. In that case, if they don't want to enter in this speculation, which is a common good game, they get an extra 50 cents. The reason for this is not obvious from the experiment. It is, however, motivated by the theoretical analysis. I have, however, no time to enter on this point. But I suppose that it plays not a big role, and I would like to make this experiment without this alternative next. So the players then can choose. They can choose whether they play a public good without the option of punishing, a public good with the option of doing peer punishment, which is a kind of self-justice, the public good with pool punishment, meaning they pay to some institution which collects fines from the defectors, and they could also abstain and say, no, I don't want to enter in these games. And the players do not know each other personally. They don't even know their names, but they are informed between each of these 50 rounds how many in their group chose which option and what was their payoff. And how to implement the peer punishment? Well, in the group, the players see how many defected, and they can then decide whether they would punish the defector, knowing that it would cost them 50 cents to impose a fine of €1 to a defector. And so this allows the players, if they see there are too many defectors around, too many free riders, then to say, no, in that case, I don't want to punish because it is going to be too costly for me. And the pool punishment, there's a different alternatives. Would be either to contribute nothing at all, or to contribute €1 to the public good game, or to contribute €1 to the public good game and 50 cents to this punishment pool. And again, for each of these 50 cents to the punishment pool, each defector is fined €1. And we can play this in the first and in the second order version. First order version means that those who do not contribute to the punishment pool will not be punished. And second order version is that those who do not contribute to the punishment pool will be punished. So this is a fairly complex game, and we had at the beginning of this experiment 1 hour to do some practice round for the players so that they could understand what happens when a public good game without punishment, in a public good game with peer punishment, in a public good game with pool punishment, and finally 10 rounds to play for the full game. And only after that, they were told, now it's serious, you play for real money, and just go ahead and see what happens. And we had 9 groups of 12 to 14 players who used the first order version, where those who do not contribute to the punishment pool will not be punished, and 9 groups that played the second order version. And what happened is that in the first order treatment, first order pool punishment, it turned out that none of these toy societies ended up with pool punishment. 3 out of the 9 ended up with peer punishment, like this example which is shown here. Yes, this ends up with almost everyone playing almost all the time peer punishment. In the second order treatment, where the, those who do not punish get punished, those who do not contribute to the police will get fined, then it turns out that six out of nine end up with pool punishment, but three other groups ended up with peer punishment. So if we show this, if we average this, the outcome is that over all groups, yes, that if there is a first order, in the first order treatment, where those who do not punish escape from punishment, then we see there is a slow decline of the peer punishers who dominate the situation over all 50 rounds, but they decline, and there is a slow increase in those who do not participate at all because the game gets more or less uninteresting. It is not really providing any payoff or much payoff. And in the second order punishment case, where those who do not punish are punished, then the situation is extremely different. It begins the same, but then the pool punishment increases. There is some peer punishment left, and but almost everyone participates in the game. So to contrast this, this is first order and this is second order, and you see that at the beginning, the initial distribution, the frequency of peer and pool is the same. But here, in the second order case, the pool punishers very quickly spread in frequencies. So the community learns that pool punishment is better than peer punishment. However, peer punishment holds its own, yes? It is not eliminated because peer punishment has, it makes sense if everyone is contributing to the common pool, why should you pay to the police? So in that case, peer punishment is a lot more efficient, yes? Let's also have a look at the cooperation, and you see that in the first order groups, the cooperation declines very much, and in the second order group, the cooperation is very stable. So, of course, in this case, in this experiment, both peer punishment and pool punishment were offered in an idealized version. Namely, so peer punishment was only addressed to those who did not contribute to the bad guys, yes? But it turns out in real-life experiments that if players have the possibility of punishing those who are good, strangely enough, they do it. At least in certain societies, they do it. They make asocial punishment. This has been impossible in the experiment that I have shown now. And on the other hand, institutional punishment was also idealized because we neglected the possibility of corrupt institutions. So let us address now, at the end, the possibility that institutions can be corrupted. And this is joint work with Ulf Diekmann, Yu Iwasa, and Yang-Hun Lee. So let's again assume this public good game. Let's, in fact, consider the very simplest situation where there are only two players. And in that case, we have just a prisoner's dilemma game. And in the prisoner's dilemma game, of course, it is well known that the best thing is to defect, but this is socially leads to a bad outcome. So now assume that there is a possibility of going, of appealing to the law, of making a contract, yes? Suppose that players can commit to an enforceable contract. They pay a certain cost S to some lawyer or so, or to a law agency, and and this law agency would then subtract a penalty A from the player if this player has played defect, yes? So this would be voluntarily submitting to some punishment. And in that case, the cooperation dominates. We can make this a little bit more sophisticated by supposing that this commitment is optional. You can decide whether you want to sign a contract, an enforceable contract, or not. Yes. So now there are four different strategies. You can be a cooperator who is willing to enter a contract. You could be, in principle, a defector also willing to enter a contract. Or you could be a cooperator who says, oh no, we won't need a judge. I don't want to sign a contract. Let's just do it by handshake or something like this. And similarly, with a non-committing defector. And you see also the payoff matrix. And now let us add a fifth strategy, the obvious strategy, the conditional cooperator. This conditional cooperator is willing to enter a contract. And if there is a contract, then he will cooperate. But if the other one is not willing to enter a contract, then this conditional cooperator will defect. And of course, this will win. So this it's very easy to see that committing and non-committing cooperators are dominated. They are not shown because they will disappear from the population, and conditional cooperators will win. But this is under the assumption that the law cannot be bribed. What happens when the law can be bribed? When the policeman can get a little bribe, or when the judge will get paid for not imposing the full penalty? This is, of course, a huge social problem, and many societies are fully aware of this and institute anti-corruption campaigns. You see, these are two posters from anti-corruption campaigns which show different degrees of sophistication, but try to eliminate corruption. So what happens if the law can be bribed? So assume that someone, a defector, can commit, say, yes, we go to the lawyer, but pays a bribe which ensures that he will not be punished. Well, in that case, the outcome, again, the committing and non-committing cooperators vanish immediately from the population, and there is a rock, paper, scissors cycle between conditional cooperators, committing defectors, and not committing defectors. The population will be mostly in this region, non-committing defectors. Sometimes there is a short burst of commitment and cooperation, but this is always short. So now, what happens if you don't know whether the law is corrupt or not? In that case, we consider again the three strategies: conditional cooperator, committing defector, and non-committing defector. And here again, the same. And here we have, on this axis, we have the degree of corruption of the enforcement. So if the enforcement is not corrupt, we get this phase. But if the enforcement is corrupt, we get this phase. And you see that the outcome is bistable. For many initial conditions, the outcome leads to this region here, this part of the edge, where everyone cooperates. But if the frequency of corrupt law enforcers is too high, then we will end up in this region, this attractor, which is an attractor consisting of defectors. Yes, there is a bistability, which is the outcome here. Yes, this shows it again. You can either end up here, cooperation, or end up here. Yes. And so far, I have shown this, what happens with social learning. If we add also a small amount of exploration rate, then the situation looks quite different, and you can get a situation where everyone cooperates. So by just trying out, if enforcers can try out, switch sometimes between corruption and honesty, then this stabler outcome will occur. And finally, I don't have time, but I also don't have enough results for speaking about this already. Finally, of course, there would be the possibility of introducing reputation effects. If you know that the law is corrupt, then you won't go there, yes? And by this, in a transparent society where you know whether the law enforcement is corrupt or not, then it is very easy to see that opportunistic conditional cooperators will win in the end. Thank you very much.